Next.js has incredible momentum, and it's for good reason. The framework brings first-class developer experience and productivity. It's no wonder developers love it. But development teams don't work in a vacuum. Developers collaborate with many other stakeholders outside of engineering. In fact, requests from across the company often get blocked on developers. They're always strapped for resources serving these requests. This is where a headless CMS comes in. We can totally use these to let non-developers help themselves and build pages and other content on the site. How do we do that? Well, first let's define the schema for our landing page. Just the title and body text, right? Oh, but what if you also want to have different sections? So a title and a list of sections, but each section should have its own title and then probably an image to go along with that. But the picture can be on the left or on the right. And where's that call to action going to be? But I want different colors for the call to action button. Oh, and some sections should show a product grid. And the grid can be from different collections and different sizes. But then for mobile, I want the grid to just show on one row. Okay, I have a schema. Then of course, I'll want to actually implement all the code that powers the schema into our website code base. Great, that's settled. Lastly, I just need to toss our marketing team some huge forms to fill out and I'm done, right? Oh, actually, marketing is now asking for a secondary call to action in the heroes, and the accordion FAQs need to support images too. Also, the design team shared a Figma file for a redesigned product grid layout. And they're also asking if we can make everything fade in on scroll. Companies spend a ridiculous amount of time modeling and implementing their visual content, even building custom bespoke plugins and tooling, and all this just so that content editors can navigate huge nested forms that look nothing like the content they're actually composing. There has to be a better way. What if we could make it easy and intuitive for anyone to directly create new user experiences without developer involvement? We could completely change our team collaboration workflow. We could free up developers to do higher leverage work. We could unblock non-developers, whether they're in marketing, design, product, and we could just help the whole organization iterate much faster. I'm Yang. I work on Plasmic. Plasmic is a headless page builder. Developers drop a snippet into their codebase, and from then on, non-developers can start visually creating surfaces in the app. Everything from landing pages to parts of existing pages. These are production-grade experiences that integrate seamlessly within our Next.js app. To the content editors, it feels like a no-code page builder, but something that makes Plasmic special is how deeply it integrates with code, your code. We'll see exactly what that means. I want to go through building a sample landing page. This demo will be using Plasmic, but I mentioned earlier, the fundamental problem is manipulating an inherently visual medium, and I want to focus the discussion more on dissecting that. Again, you can always build your own page editing infrastructure on top of something like a headless CMS. I really want to focus more on what are the things to consider when editing visual content in these real-world apps. Let's just dive in and see. We're going to take the Next.js commerce codebase and let's add a landing page to it. I'm in Plasmic in a project that's already connected to our codebase. We have this blank new page, and we can see what it looks like on desktop and mobile. Just two different views of the same thing. Let's start with designing the hero section. I'm going to add a box for the hero, and we'll add some copy. Let's center that, and let's add a background image. I want to make sure the product is centered, so I'm going to tweak the positioning just a little bit. And maybe I will make this hero a little bit taller as well. Okay, I like that, but the text is a little hard to read against this dark background, so I'm going to make it white. I'll add a call to action button right here as well. It's also a little hard to notice against this dark background, so I'm going to switch it to the inverted style. And maybe I'll play around with the layout a little bit. Great, that looks good. Maybe I'll make a few adjustments on mobile just by directly manipulating it. Great, that looks good to me. Now I'll add another section with some more copy. And I'll add a third section where I want some content side by side. So I'll insert some columns which are responsive out of the box. On the left, I'll add some nested copy. And on the right, I want to display the actual products. Now in my codebase, I have this product slider component. It's a React component, and it's doing some isomorphic data fetching of product catalog data from our commerce backend, in this case, the Shopify GraphQL API. What I'd really love to do is to reuse this in my landing page. So I'll just go ahead and register it in my Plasmic integration and specify its props. Now I can start dragging and dropping into the editor. we can go ahead and interact with its props from the right sidebar with immediate feedback. And I just want to size this to show a single product at a time. There. Taking existing and unmodified code components, especially ones with interesting logic and behavior attached, and letting you drag and drop them in the editor opens up a world of possibilities and just changes the building experience for the non-developers that you support. So now I want to add an FAQ to the bottom here. I could just start by adding some text for the FAQ. So I'll add a section, but this is really secondary content and I don't want it taking up so much attention. I have this expander component in the code. It uses this accordion from the Ant design system. It's a very generic React component. It just takes a header prop and a children prop for the body. How do we make use of this in the editor? When we register it, we can expose the header and children props as quote unquote slots. Let's insert the expander. So we have our normal props on the right, like this one, to toggle whether it's expanded. And then our slots like header are directly editable from the canvas. I'll update the body as well. Remember, this was a children prop. One thing that makes React powerful is composition. I really want to be able to add an image here or any other nested content as well. I'll just go ahead and insert an image. Or maybe I really want these side by side, so I'll nest some more structure here in the form of columns. Actually, I think I prefer the old look, so let's undo that. This ability to seamlessly interleave your design within your code within your design is what makes composition powerful. Largely, we don't really think about it at all. We want to manipulate things directly on the canvas and have it just feel natural and intuitive. For this last one, let's add a call to action button. Let's see how else we can apply this concept. I want to spruce up the page with some very light animations. There's this nice little library called React Awesome Reveal that gives you these nice effects when scrolling things into view. Let's just drop that in. I'll move some content in there. And if I scroll back to it, it's starting to fade into view. I'll tweak the settings to rise up from the bottom and also stagger the animations a bit. That's nice. So composition is very powerful. This kind of animation wasn't something that was built into Plasmic. We effectively just extended the tool's feature set. And there are many other examples like this when you can find the right level of abstraction to expose. This malleability is what makes Plasmic feel hackable, a tool that you can make your own. Now for this landing page, I want to create a product gallery section, but I'm imagining a new look that we haven't built before in our site. If we look back at our product slider, it's displaying a gallery of products with all the right data, but it hard codes the look and feel. What if I want to be able to change this from the visual editor? Let's again turn to composition and break this out into a few components. For instance, for the title, let's extract it into its own component, and it just reads from a context the data for a single product and formats and displays it. We can do the same thing for the product price and image. For the main container, I'll change the product slider into a product grid component that fetches the data from the same GraphQL endpoint and then loops over each product and provides each product as the context to its children, who are displayed in a grid. Let's add a section here and insert the product grid. It starts off empty. Now let's drag the product title in there. Now we see the names for all the products. Similarly, we can add the product image and the product price. Let's change this to point to the collection we actually want to show. And limit the count to 8 things. Now I want to add that new visual style for our product catalog. First, on mobile, I want this to be 2 columns rather than 4. Because these are all separate elements, we can essentially have unlimited design possibilities. We'll show off some of the more interesting layout capabilities. I'll just take these titles at the top. I'll make them free-floating. I'll add a background and some padding, and I'll make it bold. Great, and I'll put the price up next to it as well. I'll just copy and paste the styles. And that's pretty much all I wanted to do. So you can effectively design with real dynamic production data. And this isn't just for e-commerce. You really want to let the data be anything from any data source, whether it's social feeds or logged in database state. It can even be content from a CMS. You should complement your best of breed tools and let your CMS do what it does best, which is modeling structured data, rather than trying to model HTML and CSS and React in it. Now, the goal of this landing page is to drive conversions. I often want to A/B test ideas or add some personalization to see what works best. Let's see if this page does better if it focuses on jackets rather than boots. I'll go ahead and add what's called a variant to this page. Let's call it the jackets variant. Now I'll change the hero image, along with a few other adjustments. This isn't a hard copy of the original, it's just a set of overrides. So we can go back and keep editing our base page, and all variants are kept in sync. That's pretty much it. At the end of all this, we'll hit publish, which triggers our Vercel deployment hook, and we can see the final results on staging or production. While building a simple landing page, we just saw a few of the primarily visual concerns that pervade every action. Adding visual editing is powerful, but the rabbit hole runs deep. Maybe instead of a full page, you just want to add a section to an existing page. Maybe instead of total freedom, you want some restrictions to the structures that editors can build to help guide them. We haven't talked about quality and performance of the result, how to bake into static builds or server rendered pages, image optimization, layout shift, etc. Maybe once we start questioning our tools and collaboration workflow for building pages, we start questioning our tools and collaboration workflow for building apps. These are just a few of the things that Plasmic already enables today. All in all, it took us a few minutes to throw together a new landing page that had responsive layouts, dynamic data, interactive content, animations and effects, A/B testing. If we think about the actual code that we had to write, it's really a handful of specific building blocks that we needed, often already existing components. Most of the page didn't need code at all. Most of the content is just that, it's content. Rich, visual content. Content that we want to look good to our users. We want it to convey our story and our brand. We're just used to using code and data structures to represent that and render that content, and having developers cobble this together for the actual content owners. But it doesn't have to be this way. We can redefine what it means to edit and manage content. Teams are already seeing the effects of this change. We can share what we've observed from teams using Plasmic. Plasmic really is for everyone, and we've been lucky to see it used in a diverse set of environments. We have individuals and solo creators just building their own portfolio or side project. And on the other end, we have Fortune 500 enterprises like Intuit designing their flagship product conversion page visually, all in different versions of it. And then there's everything in between. Ecommerce has been very interesting for us. We have brands like yours who launched a headless Shopify storefront on Next.js. Migrating the whole team to a visual editing workflow helped them ship 4 times faster than before, and they're just launching campaigns nonstop. Beard Struggle also runs a Next.js storefront, and they replaced their traditional CMS infrastructure with Plasmic. That way their creative team can ship without developer involvement. We have teams like Thinking Machines using this to build out their entire Next.js marketing website. Moving beyond websites into apps, teams like PlayVersus use us in their logged-in dashboard experience. And of course, we here at Plasmic use Plasmic, not just to build out our Next.js website, but the Plasmic editor itself, this very complex and dynamic UI. Huge changes are coming in how sites are built. Next.js is leading the way in making it easy for developers to use React to build blazing fast sites. And visual editing makes it possible for marketers, designers, anyone to directly participate in the process. It's time to empower developers and content creators to do what they each do best without stepping on each other's toes and just letting the whole team move super fast. That's our focus at Plasmic. Please tell us how we're doing. Thank you.